So what this presentation is about is based on my senior thesis at the seminary. So those of you who don't know what that is, your final year at seminary, in order to graduate and receive your Master's of Divinity, you need to write a paper, a research paper, at minimum 35 pages, and the maximum is somewhere in the 60s. So you need to write a big paper on pretty much any topic of your choosing that is related to ministry. So mine is preparing Generation Z and Generation X and the struggles of teens following in the faith of their parents. I had a classmate who wrote his on stained glass and its use in the church in order to show symbolism and also to beautify the worship space. I had a classmate who wrote his on the use of politics in the pulpit and where's the fine line between using too much or maybe using none at all. So you can choose whatever you want. And so over my vicar year, my internship year, I had the privilege of working with a lot of college students in the campus ministry in South Dakota. And so seeing the faith of those kids who were involved in a public university and seeing how we would only get a very few that would show up to church while some of them may have been led astray, who knows. And so this topic was kind of near and dear to my heart as I was going through, because I had a very one-sided, bubbled experience. Church, went from preschool to eighth grade in the grade school, went to a Wells High School, Wells College, seminary, the whole thing, very bubble, one-sided thing. But that's not always the case for everybody. And so this presentation is about, what about reaching those who may have grown up in the church but never really went to the next level in a Lutheran school, a Wells school, and how their faith is challenged, but the importance of their parents teaching them and instilling in them the truths that they need in order to carry on their own lives of faith growing up. So that's what my presentation is about. And if anyone has any questions, feel free to just raise your hand and stop me throughout so that we don't have to just wait till the end for all the questions. So to start off, so my first question is your devotion to your sports team yours? The picture I have here is me and my dad when I was maybe a year old, not even able to stand on my own. I'm wearing a Calgary Flames hockey jersey. And so in that moment, did I choose to put that jersey on? No. I couldn't even stand. I can't dress myself. But the love that my dad had for that hockey team was kind of imprinted on me, and I just grew up loving hockey. Calgary Flames is my second favorite team, even to this day. It was my dad's second favorite team. And so, but over time, as you grow up, that devotion to a sports team becomes yours. Maybe you feel the same way about the Packers or whatever team that you cheer for. My sister Mackenzie and her husband Zach, and we're all at a Red Wings game. At that point, our devotion to our sports team is ours. We chose to go to that game. My dad didn't put the jersey on me and dress me at 27 years old to go to this hockey game. I did it myself. The devotion to the sports team was mine. So after my dad instilled in me a love for hockey and a love for the Red Wings, that devotion to the sports team became mine, and I ran with it to the next level. And so the question I followed up with that is your faith yours? Is the faith that you have in your heart, is it yours, or is it maybe a shadow of what your parents gave to you? And so you can see in this picture four generations of believers in my family. I have my grandma and my grandpa right in front of my dad. Those are my dad's parents. Amanda and myself, my sister, my mom, my other sister, her husband, and then my niece, Addie. And in this moment, all of us who are adults, yes, our faith is ours. We chose to be there in church. We follow God. Is my niece's faith hers? Well, yeah, first with the power of the Holy Spirit, obviously when we talk about a devotion to a sports team and your faith, those are kind of different in the fact that the Holy Spirit works faith in your hearts. The Holy Spirit doesn't do that with your love for the Packers, right? But Addie can't bring herself to church. She's too young for that. Addie can't believe. She's never going to remember on New Year's Eve with all of our family. She's not going to remember that. But Mackenzie and Zach, my brother-in-law, are instilling in Addie, even at that age, the importance of coming to church, about believing in God and worshiping Him on a regular basis. And the effects of having my grandparents do the same thing is shown with four generations being in church at the same time. And so that's an important thing. So why did I choose Generation Z and Generation X to be the kids and the parents that I'm going to talk about in the paper? Well, for starters, Generation Z is the generation that are in that age of being young adults and teenagers right now. In the research that I did, and you can probably go online and find various different dates, but generally between 1995 and 2015, that 20-year window, that is where Generation Z lies. So I was born in 93. I'm considered a millennial, a late millennial. But this is where Generation Z were typically born. They consist of 32% of the global population, so over a quarter. So it's a lot of people out there who are in this generation. And it is known as the most unchurched generation in history. So if you've ever heard of the term the rise of the nuns, N-O-N-E-S, nuns means those who are not affiliated with any religion at all. They do not say, I'm a Catholic, I'm a Lutheran, I'm a Christian, nothing. And so each generation going forward is increasingly becoming less church and more unchurched. And this generation is no different. They are also known as iGen, a little play off of iPhone or your tablets or anything like that. So they grew up with these technologies always, and they are known as the connected generation. And so let's kind of bisect what the connected generation is talking about. In the research I did, on average, the age of a child to receive a smartphone is 10. 10 years old having a smartphone, having the capabilities that we might all have if we had a phone. My parents had a rule with us as kids that we couldn't get a cell phone until we were in high school, so like 13, 14 years old. And even then, it was a flip phone, and it was a pay-as-you-go. It wasn't connected to the internet, I couldn't play games, I couldn't even text my friends willy-nilly because I would run out of minutes, and then I would have to pay for those minutes again. So it was a hassle, but today, children, on average, have a smartphone at the age of 10. They have access to the world at the age of 10. I'm sure that you might have kids or grandkids that know how to work a smartphone way better than you because they just grew up with it. That's just the case today. Wi-Fi is not a luxury, but it is a necessity in their lives. I mean, even today for us, Wi-Fi might be one of those things where it is a necessity. My laptop is connected to Wi-Fi right now. My watch is, my phone is, everything is connected to it. You can buy a stove and a fridge that are connected to Wi-Fi today. That's just the way. If you forgot to turn off your stove, you could go on your phone and turn it off from 100 miles away. It's crazy what Wi-Fi can do today. The thermostats in this church are connected to Wi-Fi so we can control them on our phone. This is not just something that is, ooh, I can connect to Wi-Fi. You know, if children do not have it today, they can't survive, it seems, without it. Created in 2004, Facebook was in the lives of Gen Z at the latest, the age of 9. I didn't get a Facebook, I think, until I was a sophomore in high school or something like that. But today, Facebook is just the thing that everyone has. If you don't have a Facebook or a Snapchat or Instagram or whatever the case may be, might be considered a little weird. So this is something that's just a part of their lives. And Google is the most valuable resource of information to them. I'm sure some of you can remember when you needed to look up a word, you opened up a dictionary, right? You didn't have spell check to do it for you. You had to go into a book and look it up yourself. If you needed to know any other information, you maybe talked to someone who knew something about it, or you went to your local library and looked up the encyclopedia to find whatever you needed to know. It took you time. Today, they have access to this kind of information instantly. If you ever do a Google search, I think it still does it, on the top it tells you how many milliseconds it took to bring up the information you asked for. It's crazy how quickly you can get access to anything. A little over a year ago, the dryer in the parsonage wasn't heating up properly. So all I did was I Googled that we had and common problems that happen when the heating doesn't work. And I found out that it was a quick little fuse. So I ordered a fuse off of Amazon and fixed it by watching a YouTube video. Back in the day, you would have had to call an appliance technician and pay hundreds of dollars to make that happen, or just tinker with it until the whole thing was broken. But today, you can do that instantaneously. You can find out information for anything you want to know. So what is the mission of this generation? Because every generation has a mission, something that they and that generation are striving to do in the world. Well, their mission is influenced by their parents. And I think that can be said about every generation, that what you want to do moving forward in your life is to kind of take what your parents did and go forward with it. Because you always want to make the world a better place for your kids than it was when you were in it, right? So their mission is influenced by their parents, and they want to kind of carry that and run with it. Their mission is to become more accepting. We are not many generations removed from when segregation was a thing in our country, right? That was only a couple decades ago, maybe more than a couple decades, but you get what I'm saying. So their mission is to become more accepting of everyone, and because they have access to the world, they can be accepting of so many more countries and people than we could ever think of in the past. Ultimately, their mission is to fix the world. I think we'd all be lying if we said that the world was not broken. There are things inherently wrong in our world because of sin, but it is the mission of Gen Z to try to fix the world and make it a better place. And so let's talk about the parents who are typically in Generation X. So this would be those who are before millennials, so Generation X, millennials, Generation Z. And so just for the sake of this paper, I chose to focus on Generation X as their parents. And questions that those parents might have are, am I a helicopter parent? Maybe you've heard that phrase before, where you as a parent need to make sure that you are not constantly hovering over your kids and constantly checking in on them and like watching their location on their phone and every 5 minutes when they're away from the house saying, what's up, what are you doing? Who are you hanging out with? Where are you? So parents need to make sure and they ask themselves those questions. Or am I a lawnmower parent? And this one I found doing the research. And what it means is, am I willing and am I going to mow over anyone and anything that gets in the way of my child's happiness? Am I going to be in front of them plowing the way to make sure that they are going to have an easy life and a better life? And so these are questions that this generation asks themselves. And sometimes those two questions can have sort of negative connotations because they want to make more independent children. Eventually, the kids are going to have to leave the house. So let's make them a little more independent. Let's make them able to go out on their own. If they have a cell phone, you can send them out and know that you can make sure that they're going to be okay. I remember back when I was a kid, I didn't have a cell phone. The way I knew that I needed to come home from a friend's house if we were outside playing is when the street lights come on, you're home. Or when the sun sets, you're home. That's when we would have to go home. But today, it's just a quick text, a quick call, hey, come home now. But they're trying to make more independent children. And in the research I did, more independent equals more likely to not attend church. You are making your kids more independent and staying away from being a helicopter parent or a lawnmower parent too much, then that might become a problem. Where now your kids can tell you, no, I want to go to church this Sunday. And then how do you respond? Do you just say, okay, that's fine, you're making your own decisions, don't go to church, that's okay. Or are you instilling in them the importance of showing up to church on a regular basis? So the question that parents need to ask themselves is, what is my attitude about church? And this can be a factor at multiple times. Let's just say on a Sunday morning. When you're getting ready for church on a Sunday morning, how are the parents reacting? Is it bickering and arguing about who needs to change a diaper and who has to get the kids ready and who's putting the kids in the car and all these conversations that can turn into arguments? Kids pick up on that. If the parents are bickering before church on Sunday, church doesn't sound like a good thing if mom and dad are going to be fighting every Sunday morning. So you need to be aware of what you're doing in front of your away to church once you're in the car. After the bickering happened, are you just like sitting in silence, angry on your way to church, and the kids are kind of afraid to speak up? That's the attitude we need to think about. And then when you show up in church on a Sunday morning, is it just making a beeline from the doors to your pew and sit there in silence and not talk to anybody? Or are you going to stop and greet people and stand in the narthex for a while and chat and have a conversation? Because kids pick up on that. Am I here to be involved with the people around me? Or am I here just to sit in my pew quietly and not say a word to anybody? Kids pick up on that. Because kids' brains from birth till their adolescence years are just growing. Like they soak things up like sponges. You guys know this as parents, right? They pick up on things that you do and the mannerisms that you have without you even teaching them to them. And so this is the same thing about church. And then during the church service, what is your attitude? Is it sitting there, arms crossed, just staring up at the front, not opening your mouth at all? Kids pick up on that. During the hymns, even if you're not a great singer, are you at least opening your mouth a little bit to show your kids that you're following along? And I use this example. My grandpa, bless his heart, he's in heaven with Jesus right now, but he could not sing to save his life. He was the most tone-deaf person I've ever heard in my entire life. But he sang. Right? Like he opened his mouth and he sang, and if you sat next to him, you couldn't carry a tune because he was like ruining your inner tonality. But he sang, and that was music to God's ears. It was great. So even if you're not a great singer, how are your kids viewing you worshiping? Is it a positive experience or is it a negative experience? Because I remember as a kid, growing up, I didn't know how to sing hymns. I thought the way you sang hymns was you went, this is the first verse, this is the second verse, this is the third and the fourth. I didn't know that you had to go all the way down. And so for a long time, my parents had to sit there with their finger and help me sing the hymns. So that's an important thing, teaching your kids what worship is about and how it works. I didn't know how to say all the confessions. I didn't know how to say the prayers. Those are things that were taught to me through years and years of being in church. I didn't know how to sing A Mighty Fortress Is Our God like we sang today. It's a beloved hymn by everyone, but I didn't grow up just knowing it inherently. My parents had to teach me, right? And then after church, what is your attitude? Do you buzz out of the church as quickly as you can without talking to anybody? And then when you get in the car, you just complain about how long the sermon was, or the hymns that were sang weren't the ones that you liked, and all of these things, you're just complaining about church, and oh, so-and-so said this to me. Kids pick up on that. So it's an important thing to make the whole church experience a very positive thing for your children, because then it becomes a positive thing for them. And so the last thing, am I nurturing their faith or am I making it a shadow of mine? As I mentioned earlier, faith is theirs because when they are baptized, the Holy Spirit is working faith in their hearts. But you as a parent, you make a promise to God that you are going to bring them to church and nurture their faith. Because you are not just making a carbon copy of your faith and putting it in your child's heart. It is theirs. It is their own. So are you going to nurture it and help them grow in their faith? That's the question that parents need to be asking themselves. Any questions so far? Okay. So, during this, my thesis preparation, which took like that first semester of my senior year, I decided to do a survey to talk to people in Generation Z and ask them about their experiences with church and growing up with their parents who might have been or might not have been in the church. And instead of doing a survey to all of my classmates, because that would have been a very one-sided survey, because we're all studying to be pastors, right? I think we all would have had a very similar experience growing up. But my senior year, I was a vicar of sorts at Wisconsin Lutheran College. So I helped out with their chapels, and I did some tutoring for them in the library at night sometimes. And so Wisconsin Lutheran College, despite the fact that it is Lutheran and almost all the teachers are Wells, you can go there for any degree you want, whether it's nursing or business or finance or something else. And so there are lots of different people there from all walks of life, Wells, not Wells, all sorts of religions. And so I figured this, giving this survey to them, would make it a more broad thing, so I could get a lot more information from it. Wells, Catholic, Buddhist, whatever, just religious in general. 72 of them, so about 88% said, yes, I am religious of some kind. Almost 10% said non-religious in the categories of atheist and agnostic. Like, I don't believe in God, but I am an atheist. Like, that is my religion, so to speak. And then two people responded, none of the above. I don't consider myself atheist or agnostic or religious. I'm none. I'm nothing. So it was good to see that most of them at least were religious. Then I asked them, did you grow up attending church regularly? About three quarters of them said, yes, I attend church regularly, and the other quarter said, no, they did not. Obviously, you know, this should be 100% yes, but then that's just the reality. And that's what I wanted to see. I wanted to see the reality of what Generation Z was facing in their lives growing up. And then I asked them, on average, how often do you attend church in a year? About 12% of them said zero times. We never go to church. About 8.5% of them said one to two times, for example, on Christmas and Easter, commonly known as the Creasters, people that, because you have to go to church on Christmas, you have to go to church on Easter, but no other time during the year. Three or four times a year, that was a quarter of them. So they go once a quarter, they show up to church. Over 14.5% said once a month we go to church. Two to three times a month, that was 16%. And then I hardly miss a service was another quarter. So kind of interesting that most of them fell in this like three to four times a year to I hardly miss a service, which is a good thing. But obviously we would love to see it more in this range with all of them being there. And then asked them, if you clicked yes to attending church, how would you answer this? I enjoy my time at church. And so the scale goes from one being I hate it, I never want to go ever again, to I love it, I don't want anything to change about church. So thankfully, most of them went from like the very neutral side of things to the positive side of things. So that was good to see, but most of them, about half of them, fall in this category of I like church, but maybe there's something that we can change to make it better for me. And so I kind of went into that later on in my survey. And then asked them, were your parents a positive or negative influence on your church life? Overwhelming majority, 92.7% said it was positive, which was fantastic to see. And then the negatives were 14%. Obviously, it's sad to see that this was even as high as it was, but that's the reality that some people are facing. Then I asked them some questions that involved more than just picking an option. This was them actually relaying to me information. So I asked them, to describe how your parents were a positive or a negative influence on your church life. And out of the 82 responses, I put just a few up here, I think six of them, three positive, three negative, just to give you the kind of the general consensus of what they said. A positive one. They helped me to understand what was going on and pushed me to have a closer walk with Christ. Kind of like my parents did in explaining to me how hymns work, it's important that you, as a parent, are making sure that your kids are understanding what's going on in the service. Why are we standing up when we're standing up? Why are we singing these hymns? Why are we doing these responsive prayers? All that stuff. And then pushing them to have a closer walk with Christ. Again, not making it your faith on them, but saying, hey, you and God have a special relationship that is different from my relationship with God, because God loves you as an individual. Let's get you closer to Christ as an individual. Someone else said, put me in well schools my whole life and encouraged me to participate in church activities, but never forced me to go. I mean, this is kind of like me growing up. I was in well schools my whole life. My parents encouraged me to do things like PBS and Sunday school, but it was never a forced thing. And so that's important too. Another positive one, they have been great examples of congregation members that are loyal to their church. They participate in church activities and are active members. Again, kids see this. If they see that you are involved and that you are putting your name on sign-up sheets and you are there for more than just a service and then leaving, kids see that. They see that church is important to you as an individual, not just for a place where you come and sit for an hour and leave, but it becomes a part of your life. And then I had some negatives. I was forced to go to the service and never liked it. It was sad to see that that was someone's experience, that they never liked coming to church. Only one parent would go to church and the other would stay home. This one's huge. When both parents are involved, we were just talking about this at breakfast Bible study the other day. When both parents are involved in the faith of a child and in the worship life of a child, the odds of the child continuing in their faith is like over 90%, overwhelming positive influence. And then if only a father is involved in the faith life of a child, it goes down. And then if only the mother is involved, it goes down even further. And if none are involved, it goes down to almost zero. So even just the father being involved is a tremendous positive influence in the faith life of a child, because that is the father's job as the leader of the family, is to bring their children to church and get them involved and be that positive influence. But especially with both. Obviously the dream is to have both parents be involved in the faith life of the child. And then the last negative, a big one that kind of hit me, was they fought about religion a lot. I think this can happen particularly in a family where maybe the parents are divided, maybe one is Catholic, one is Lutheran, maybe one isn't religious and one is, and that can be a sense of contention, where the parents are fighting about religion, or maybe even you go to the same church, but you fight about what you're hearing at church, and that can be a hugely negative influence on a child's life.
How did you get your people who answered these questions involved in this? Did you just randomly go up to people, or did you have to, like...
No, so with my connections at Wisconsin Lutheran College, I worked with the campus pastors who taught some religion classes, and I had some other connections with other professors. So I gave it to them, and then they gave it to their classes and said, hey, for some extra credit, can you do a survey for one of our campus vicars? And so that's how I got them to participate in this. Obviously, I wish I would have had more, but I think 80 was a pretty sufficient amount for my paper. Any other questions so far? I don't want to skip anyone. You might have something that just popped in your head. Okay. Moving on. I then asked them, how often do you talk about religion at home? Whether it was positive, whether it was negative. 17% said never. Church never comes up. Worship never comes up at church. Over half, about two-thirds of them said once in a while, for example, we occasionally talk about what was going on at church. That's important to talk about what you might have heard that day on Sunday. But obviously, we would love to do this regularly. We have family devotion on a regular basis. So we read God's word together. That was about 20%. I then asked, what do you enjoy about church? When you show up, what were some positive things that you were gleaning from the worship service? One of them was spending time in God's word in a community of believers. Obviously, having a community feel, a family feel at a church is important. And spending time in God's word, that's what we're here for. The family atmosphere and the relationships I have built with congregation members, the ability to show my gifts and share them with others in a religious setting. And this is awesome too, the family atmospheres I talked about is important, relationships that they have built with congregation members. So when you bring your kids to church, you know, I hope the kids aren't just kind of like standing next to you, never talking with anybody, but introduce them, especially when they're old enough to really like have a conversation. Introduce them to your friends and the people in the church so that it becomes theirs, that they feel comfortable with the people that are sitting around them. And then the ability to show my gifts and share them with others in a religious setting. As we heard in the Wells Connection, that was a perfect Wells Connection for today. Using kids and the gifts that they have to go and do things in the church, because they have gifts that we might not even think of. They have access to things that we can't even imagine. So let's use them. I enjoy the worship, singing part of church, and talking with others. That was an awesome thing to see. The architecture of the stained glass, even the building that we sit in, has a factor on what kids think about church. If it is a dimly lit church and everyone's falling asleep, that's not a very positive atmosphere, right? But if it's nice and bright and inviting, and the architecture is good, and it enhances your worship experience. It's not the end-all, be-all of worship, because that's God's word. But it is important to have a building that matters, and a building that is giving glory to God. I love the message because I can always relate to them in my life. And this one's kind of on me and all other pastors to make sure that the message that they are preaching from the pulpit is not just something that we're telling to the older people. It's something that is relatable to everyone. It's something that even younger kids can grasp and comprehend. That's important. At times, I feel as if the messages that are put out through the services are directed at me and gives me a more significant feel of the service. And that's my goal, again, as the pastor who preaches, to make these applications of God's word pointed and directed and touching on sins that might be affecting everyone of all ages, and then how we can apply what God wants us to do in all of our lives. And so that's an important thing, too. And then I asked, what do you dislike about church? A lot of people said, I don't dislike anything about church, and that's great, but obviously there are some people that might have some grievances, so let's talk about it. Sometimes it went pretty long. I had a lot of people say that. And I'm not saying that a church service needs to be 1 hour. If it's not, then that's not good. But if church services are lasting hour and a half, hour 45 of communion, that's a long time to be sitting in the pews. Even if it's with God's word, it's just a long time in general. I had a lot of kids talk about that. If the sermons are long, I sometimes get distracted. Many responses said something similar to that. I don't think I've ever accused of being long-winded in my preaching. If you go on our YouTube channel, I think all my sermons are between like 11 and 15 minutes, somewhere in that range. But if sermons are going 25, 30 minutes, that's a lot, even for adults to sit through. But especially with kids who are known to have a lesser attention span, that can be extremely difficult. Even if you are the most engaging preacher in the whole world and you're hanging on the edge of your seat, it can be a long time. So that's important for pastors to realize that, yes, you can add as much stuff as you want in the service, but to make it pointed and to make it efficient, that is important too. Especially in a Welsh church, it seems as though there is a certain way members have to behave and have to show their faith. People express their faith in different ways, and someone who is different can have just as strong of a faith as someone who acts in a more conservative manner. So I liken this to maybe like contemporary worship. We don't do something like that here. But if you would go to the Core in Appleton, or even St. Mark's in Green Bay, or there's a place down in Muskego, St. Paul's in Muskego, they have a contemporary worship service. And I went to one of those once when I was at the seminary. And I had never really been involved with contemporary style worship. But to see people standing up with like hands in the air praising God, ooh, I kind of felt a little uncomfortable. And I think some kids feel like if they express their faith in that way, if that style of church resonates with them, and then they come to a place like this, and it's like, no, you must sit here and be quiet and stand up when you're told to stand and speak when you're told to speak, it can be very rigid for them. And so they feel like, I want to express my faith in a way that feels natural to me, according to God's word, obviously. But if it is more contemporary style where they want to stand up and they want to sing, that's fantastic. We should not hinder that. And I'm not saying that we need to change our worship service here or make it different, but I'm saying in some context, this can be an important thing for many young people's faith. Another negative, I feel like it can be different Monday through Saturday and forgiven on Sunday. I talked about that in a sermon not too long ago about being a Pharisee with how we act. Or maybe on church we can talk the talk and walk the walk and act like we are these perfect people that never sin. And then we walk out those doors and all of a sudden we're using God's name in vain and we're gossiping and we're doing all these things that are not good, not according to God's word. And people see that. Kids pick up on that. Are you being a different person outside those doors than you are in here? Are you being fake? Are you being a Pharisee? Those are important things we need to realize. Last one, I find that in the Wells, church is rather robotic. We go through almost identical church services each week, with the difference being what the sermon is about. And that's an important thing that we hear in our worship. We try to make sure that it is not the exact same thing every single week. So I'm sure some of you can remember, in the Lutheran hymnal, there were two different orders of worship. It was the service of the word and sacrament, and you did the same thing pretty much every week. And here, we try to change things up, not in a way where it's trying to confuse everyone. But on the first Sunday of the month, we do a certain worship service. Second Sunday, we do a different one. Third Sunday, we do a different one, and that repeats by a month, so that it keeps it fresh in our minds. That it's not the same thing we're doing every week, and after a while, it just becomes robotic memory. It becomes something that we actually think about. And especially with this new hymnal, we have new hymns that try to freshen things up. I love old hymns, and I'm not saying this new hymnal is like God's gift to the Wells. But there are sometimes we like to throw new hymns in there. We like to throw new ways to say a song. Because kids care about that kind of stuff. They don't necessarily want to hear all the old stuff over and over again, but to do something new. And again, kids didn't grow up knowing this by memory from birth. It took a while to get used to things, and same thing with adults. It takes a while to get used to new things, but kids care about doing stuff that's new, stuff that's fresh. So that's an important thing to think about with church. Ask if you could improve your church experience, how would you do it? One said, if I could improve my church experience, I would want my church to incorporate new music that relates to our generation and make it an exciting, uplifting service while still teaching both law and gospel. And this is the important thing. Nothing in the service can change at all the long gospel. That needs to be there every single time. That can never change. If a youth came in here from Gen Z and said, get rid of the law, not going to happen. That is the one thing we're going to stand on. But when it comes to how we use new music and how we use choirs and how we make it an uplifting service, those are the kinds of things that we can do to make church more accessible to young kids. More powerful and relatable messages. This one's kind of on me as the pastor. To make sure that every week I am getting my best in my sermon prep, that I am making my sermons efficacious and good. And because the word is efficacious and it works, but the way it's delivered matters too. And so that's on me to make sure that I can make the sermon powerful and make the message relatable. If I ask questions, I would like them to be answered and not like told that I'm being too nosy. If someone has a question about why we do this in the worship service, don't just say, because we do, end of story. But like talk with them, say, hey, here's why we do what we do. And make sure that if they're asking questions about, you know, I don't know, elders or trustees or something on the council, don't just say, that's for the men of the congregation, don't ask questions. They can ask questions. This is their church too. And so to make sure that if they come up and they have questions, that we answer them, that we talk with them, here's why we do what we do at this church. Less hypocrites. That kind of goes into the being a different person outside of church than you are in church. Because we are to reflect the love of Christ everywhere we are, not just here in the pews on Sunday morning. Talk to my pastor about changes that I want to see. Again, this one on me specifically, and I hope that I'm someone that anyone can come up and if you have a concern, if you have a question, come talk to me. Especially for young kids. I'm here to talk. I'm here to help with whatever questions you might. I ask them, what would make a church feel like home to you? Because that's important. We call it a home congregation for a reason, because this is where you come, this is where you meet with your church family, and you worship together, and you enjoy fellowship. So what's going to make it feel like home to you? Being closer to a lot of members, and lots of light. Again, make it a bright, inviting worship space. That's important. Being close with a lot of the members, not just I know the face, but I know nothing about you, but have relationships with each other. A sense of community, like people there truly care about me. We are told to share in one another's burdens. That is the job of a Christian. If someone is struggling with something, we talk with them, we take that struggle on ourselves and say, let's work through this together with God's word. And so that's important, care about each other. A pastoral figure who can relate to everyone and guide me through troubling times. Again, on me to be someone who can help someone if someone comes into my office and says, I'm struggling right now, Pastor. I need help, that I can be there for them. Feel like I can confide in others. Again, sharing in one another's burdens and sins. That I knew my whole congregation on a personal level. And that's kind of on the parents, too, when kids are growing up, to introduce them to different members of the congregation. Oh, here's so-and-so. Here's what they do. Maybe you can, you know, talk with them and get to know them even better. Everyone knows everyone and connects outside of church. And that's important, too. If there are events that the church puts on, are people involved, or do you only see them on Sunday mornings? And then everyone knows each other and enjoys the presence of one another. And I think in this church family, for the most part, I think we have this down. We know each other. And I think enjoying the presence of one another can be difficult sometimes, but to make sure that we are showing humble Christian love in all of our interactions with one another and enjoying being here, having a smile. in the church. That is so important. Any questions on any like the survey questions that I did through and pass that from now on? Okay. So, how do we reach Gen Z? How do we reach out to them? How do we talk with them? This is a quote that I got from Dean Boardman in a book that I read for this paper. He said, "Too often we've considered youth apart from their families and the other primary systems that surround and support or fail to support them. All microsystems are important. The family, the neighborhood community, your schools, media, peers, and maybe church. Because everything, all of these things that I just read, they affect your life. Where you live in the community, that affects you. Your school affects you. Your sports affect you. The media you watch on TV and on your phone, that affects you. Your classmates affect you. The church does. But in most cases, though, family, for positive or negative reasons, remains the most influential. So we will begin our discussion with the family. We as the church can try and come up with every and anything we can think of to reach Gen Z. Let's have this youth group. Let's do this thing. Let's go on a trip. Let's do all these fun things for youth, and that's fine. But is that the best place to start? This author suggests we start with the family. And that relies on parents. Are the parents a positive influence on the life of a child and on their faith? That's where we have to start. Because if it's a negative influence at home, the odds of getting those kids to come in church and do stuff is going to be astronomically hard. But to have parents be a positive influence, that makes everything so much easier after that, especially in church. How else can you reach them? Use them. They love to collaborate with others. We saw that in our Wells connection, that they love to be involved and to do things. And they have different perspectives. They love to use their gifts to serve God, so let's try our best to use them. Because they love to collaborate. You can see that on social media. They're always connected with their friends. They're texting, they're Snapchatting, whatever the case may be. They can work well with others. We just need to find a way to use them. They are very aware of the impact an organization or church has on the world and the community around them. I don't know if you've ever seen like a billboard or a website or a social media post that was clearly written by someone who has no idea how it's going to affect something. Like there's spelling mistakes and it sounds bad and it doesn't flow well. Gen Z understands what it's like to post something online and to know what kind of effect it's going to have. Because they know if I post a picture like this, it's going to get no likes. No one's going to look at it. If I post something like this, it's going to get some eyes. It's going to be seen. It's going to get liked. So especially when it comes to our impact online, that's important. With our website, that's important too. If you open up a church website and it looks like it's going to give your computer viruses, that's not a good thing. That's going to be a negative impact on how people view our organization. But if it's clean and it's got pictures and it's up to date all the time, that's so important. And even when we put out maybe posters and flyers, are these things that people are going to see? Is this going to be a positive influence or a positive impact? And Gen Z, they know how to do that stuff. They thrive on involvement that helps them feel at home in their environment. Again, if they're involved and they can make connections and they can feel at home, it is a positive experience. They're going to want to do that more. But if it's something that they aren't involved, they just feel like, I'm a passive believer here. I just come here and I just receive the word and I leave. That's not a good impact. How else can we reach Gen Z? We have to teach them. And that starts in the home. Encouraging parents to be in the word at home always. Whether it's talking about what happened at church, whether it's asking the kids how school was, hey, what did you learn? If you learned something that's contrary to God's word, let's talk about it. Or even if it's just reading a meditation's devotion right after you get done eating, or whatever the best time is to be with all of your family at once, that's important. Help them defend their faith. And this especially, I think, goes for those who go to public schools, because I'm going to be honest, I never really had to do this when I went to all the well schools, because everyone was the same faith as me. But if you're outside of well schools and outside of Christian morals and influences, this can be something that kids deal with on a daily basis. Help help them defend their faith, give them answers to questions that they might have or that might be asked of them to help them. Equip them to witness their faith. Help them not just to have the faith, but tell others about the faith and to be able to have conversations with others about it. Not just kind of sitting shyly by and people are just berating them with questions saying, I don't know, ask my pastor, to be able to defend their own faith, because that's important, and witness it. Show them why we do what we do. Again, like my parents did with the hymns growing up, why do we worship like we do? Why do we sing the hymns that we sing? Why do we do a confession of faith after the sermon? Why do we have the readings that we do? Why is one from the Old Testament, from an epistle, and from a gospel? Why do we do that? And so to show kids why we do what we do helps them feel more at home. It helps them feel involved. And so the last slide here is something that we all who do these theses put, because when we give this presentation at a seminary, we have students who are maybe classes below us, and we also have professors who sit and watch these presentations. And so if this, my presentation, made another student think, I could run with that somewhere, where could I go with that to kind of take it to the next level? Maybe someone could do a thesis on home family Bible studies. How can you equip parents to do Bible studies at home that are good and that are effective? How can we use youth in the church? And I think the Wells Connection talked about that. How can we use them? How can maybe we get them going door to door? How can we involve them in worship and activities that we do at church? Or how can I overcome adversity as a member of Gen Z? Being in the largest generation that's alive on this earth, and being the most unchurched generation in history, the adversity is just skyrocketing than maybe what we even feel as a part of our current generation. So how can we overcome the adversity of that? So that's the slide that I end with at the seminary. Does anyone have any questions on anything that we talked about today? Bob?
Just thinking outside the box, if you would take your thesis now and have done it after COVID hit, how do you think your responses and so on might have changed?
I did write it after COVID hit. So just to give some context about when this was done. So my vicar year was fall of 2019, spring of 2020, or like summer of 2020. So like right when COVID hit was when I was a vicar. So I think COVID didn't hit South Dakota until like way after the rest of the country because it was being out in the middle of nowhere. So I don't think COVID really hit South Dakota until like that March of 2020. And then we ended up not having like in-person worship for a couple months there, and we got back into it pretty quickly. So this was written completely as we were kind of like making our way out of COVID. So I don't know if I would necessarily, and a part of the reason why I didn't really mention that in here is because I kind of wanted this paper to be timeless. I didn't want it to be like, this is only focused on what you can do when COVID is happening, but to make it more general, how can we do this? But that would definitely be a paper topic. Like, after, like, post-COVID, how can we help get people involved in the church again? Does that kind of answer your question?
It sort of does.
Okay.
And I guess the other part of it would be, if it was during that time frame, why did you not include questions for things of like not being in church worship?
Sure.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, and I actually did get a few responses to my survey, because at WLC, obviously, it was affecting them too at that time. And I definitely did get responses like, how would you change worship? I don't want to wear masks anymore. Or I want to have in-person worship again. So I did get some of those answers. I just didn't include them. So there were kids that were saying, like all of us, I want to be in church. I want to not have to wear a mask. I don't want to have to social distance anymore. And so those were definitely things that kids were feeling and that they were going to change to get back to normal, so to speak. Any other questions?
How can we at St. Paul use our youth more in the church?
Yeah, I mean, I think for starters, we're trying to do our best with that already. I mean, we have a woman who sits in the back and helps out with our PowerPoint. If anyone, I mean, we've had the helps out with Sunday school downstairs as a helper, not necessarily as a student. So we're trying our best to already do that, to equip them to do things in the church. Because eventually, there might be youth in this church that aren't going to stay here for us. So when they go to their new congregation, are they going to have tools they can use to say, hey, when I go to this new church, I can go do this, or I'm good at this. So I think we're trying our best as the leaders of this church to say, hey, I can see these gifts in you, let's use them. Even if there's a lot of people in that specific vein using the same gifts to get them involved too. So I think we're trying our best, but there's always things that could be done. And the thing is, like, I'm just one person that tries to see the gifts of everybody. But if everyone is looking at the youth and saying, hey, I can see this gift in you, let's see if we can use it. I think that's on all of us as congregation members, as a family, to talk to each other and do those things. Any other questions?
I guess I have a comment. I really appreciate in the thesis how you called out, generalized the different negative opinions, I'll say, of that people in that generation have with the church.
Sure.
Because I just think that's a good thing to keep in mind of trying not to fall into those traps of being the anti-church, being against everything.
Right.
Or showing that side of things.
Yeah. If there's anything in this presentation that made you go, huh, I wonder if I said more about it. I probably did. There are copies of my whole thesis by the mailbox if you would like to read through the whole thing. If not, you can go on the Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary essay file and just type in my name and you'll get my thesis there too if you want to view it online. But if you would like to read the whole thing and get a bigger context of my paper, you can read it if you want to sit down and read like a 40-page paper.
How many pages is it?
It's like 40 pages. Yeah, it was a lot to write, but I graduated, so I have to write. Anyone else have any questions? Any comments? Okay. Well, thanks for sitting through this presentation. I hope it was informative. I hope it sparked some questions in your mind about what we can do to